On this episode of Our Two Cents, my guest is Nancy Friedman of Kids Views. She is an expert on internet safety for kids. You're going to want to stay tuned to this episode. Nancy, thank you so much for being on this episode of Our Two Cents. You are one of the co-founders of Kids Views, and so you have a vested interest in kids and internet safety. What should parents be aware of when they're talking to children about having access to the internet?
I think the most important thing that parents need to understand is that despite all the doom and gloom, despite all of the things you hear about cyberbullying and abductions and teens killing themselves over being cyberbullied and all that stuff, that when you actually analyze the data and look at what's out there in the past 10 years, so that means since the advent of Facebook and YouTube and everybody having cell phones and emails, all those numbers are a flat line. Teen suicide, flat line. Incidents of bullying, flat line. Abductions, all of it. It hasn't really changed. Does that mean that the game hasn't changed, that social media hasn't affected all of those issues? Of course not, it has. Things last longer, things are more far-reaching. But the bottom line is their effects on kids haven't really changed that much. So as a parent, I think that should be reassuring. Yes, all those things still happen and they're bad, but it's not as much worse as it was before as people think.
So we're just more aware of it. One story hits the news cycle and that it stays in the news cycle for a week or 2 weeks, and then another one will pick up. Is that what you're seeing?
I think it's that, and I also think it's that this generation of kids that's coming out now, this generation of kids is the first generation that is born into a digital world where it's just part of the fabric of their lives, whereas our generation of parents adopted it much quicker than our own parents did. We weren't born into a world where it just exists. So it's still a little bit foreign to us and a little bit more scary. And it is out there longer, but I think that the thing to understand is that all of these issues of kids hurting themselves or kids being abducted or, you know, terrible things happening with children that have happened throughout history are not so much influenced by social media as they are just an unfortunate part of, you know, life.
Yeah, that's how I was going to say it, was just life in general. It's just how our society and how we are living is melding with social media, and they're just combining, and that's what's happening.
Right, so in a weird way, it should be reassuring to parents to know that it isn't making it worse, which doesn't mean you don't need to tell your kids about the dangers of social media, and doesn't mean it's not opening up new avenues for icky things to go on, but just to know that it's not all as awful as you think. And the vast majority of certainly older kids who are on social media are just using it as a way to connect with the people they already know. Most teenagers, and this is supported by studies, most teenagers are using social media to talk to their friends.
Yeah, it's the new passing notes in class. Do you like me? Circle yes or no.
Right.
But it's
exactly
a little bit more than that, but this is how they're communicating.
Right. And I think as kids get further and further away from being able to go out and socialize with their friends, you know, kids aren't allowed to ride their bike places anymore, or walk places anymore. Parents are nervous. The way that they can be out there in public with their friends is in a digital public. So that's what they're using social media for. It's not really to go out there and find, you know, strangers online. That's not really what they're doing.
Yeah. So when you're talking to younger kids, my kids are, they're under 13 years old. So how do you explain that to them, that you need to be cautious when you're out on the internet without it being so scary? How do you put it in terms that they are cautious but understand?
Well, I think the same way you do in life. You know, you talk about stranger danger when they're really little, and you don't talk to strangers unless your mom's around or unless someone you trust is with you and knows them as well. I think it's not that different. It's the same kind of conversation you'll have. It's just about digital. You know, you're talking about what your kids should do and not do in real life is not that different from what they should do and not do in the virtual world. You wouldn't tell a stranger on the street where you live and where you go to school and when your birthday is and who your parents, you know, you wouldn't do any of that in real life. It's the same conversation. So whatever techniques you use when talking with them how to deal socially in the real world should really be the same things you're telling them about their life online.
I agree. And when we were, before we had started this interview, you and I were having a little side conversation. You were telling me about the three B's with social media in kids. What were those again?
The first one is to be proactive. So like what you were saying, when your kids are younger, start talking to them early and often. Let them know that you're open to the conversation. So, you know, be out there talking to your kids. Be proactive about having the digital conversation. The second one is to be aware. There are lots of apps out there for parents who say, oh, I have no idea what's going on in the digital world. I don't even know. Yeah, that is like saying, I have no idea where my kids go after school, or I have no idea who my kids' friends are, or I have no idea what parents are, you know, picking them up from a sleepover. You know what's going on in your kids' lives. As parents, part of your responsibility now is to be aware of what's going on in their digital lives too. So no more being like, oh, I don't know anything about the digital world. Like that's not being a good parent anymore because your kids are there.
It's not an excuse. It's
just, right.
You need to be into it.
And then the last one is be available. You want to be able to, you want your kids to feel that you're available to talk to them about things that have gone on the internet. I have a piece I wrote on my blog about, it's called Real Life Lessons from a Digital World, which was when my daughter a few years ago was in a virtual world that she should not have been in, and some creepy virtual guy made a creepy virtual pass at her and she freaked out. She came to me right away and talked to me about it, and I was really happy, not happy that that happened, but happy that she felt she could come to me and discuss it. And the reason that she could is I had followed the first B, which is to be proactive. And I've already been talking to her, so she knew that we could have that conversation. That's important in any aspect of parenting. But a lot of times parents are so nervous about the digital space that they don't want to do that. Mm-hmm. It's important.
Yeah, I agree. And we have dipped our children's toes into social media a little bit. My daughter has an Instagram account. She knows where it is on my phone, and she knows her username, but she does not know her password. She has no idea what it is. She hands it to me and says, can I check Instagram? And she wants to go and check and see what her crafty friends are doing and what her girlfriends at school are doing, and she likes to like them, and she'll leave little comments like, I like that, or where did you find that? But we've had the conversation that you need to show me what you're doing. I go through her feed. I see what she's liking. Before she hits go and before she hits post, she has to show me what it is. So she knows that I know what is going out there. And then we also talk about that just because someone likes all of the pictures that you have on Instagram doesn't mean that you need to follow them. Or just because someone follows you doesn't mean that you need to follow them. And we talk about building community that way and why she's using Instagram. So what other conversations do you think I should be having with her about Instagram or other social media platforms?
I think that what you're doing is great. I think that 99.9% of parents are not going to do that. They're just not going to go that far to have to see every single photo. I mean, it's great that you're capable. Most parents don't want to be bothered. That's the truth.
It's just where we are in our lives. It works with our flow, and it doesn't work for everybody. That's just what we do.
Right. I mean, I think that, like, if on an extreme of like how great you can be at it, you're like at the top end. But I think most people fall like middle to low.
Okay.
So I think that it's. I think the first thing parents should know is that it's actually illegal for your kid to be posting to Instagram. It does not criminalize your child. It criminalizes Instagram for taking those photos, but it's not just a rule. So if as a parent you want a reason to keep your kid off of Instagram, Facebook, Pinterest, Twitter, kids aren't really there anyway, but any of those things, that's always the reason you can give. And I think that the most important thing is, because despite all of those laws, kids are on it, everybody knows it, Instagram knows it too. Despite that, they're there, so we need to deal with the reality. The single most important thing you can do is to make sure that the GPS function on your child's cell phone is turned off if they're using their own phone to post, because that means that someone can tap their photo and find a geolocator exactly where they are, pinpointed to where they are precisely at the time they took the photo. That to me is a scary thing. Despite the flat line of abductions, that's a scary thought. So that sometimes is a setting on the phone itself, not necessarily an Instagram setting. So you might have geolocation turned off on Instagram, but you need to look at the phone itself to make sure that photos, so when they take a photo that's on their phone and then upload that photo, the photo itself isn't geotagged. That's a setting on most phones.
Another thing I talked to her about is the types of photos that she posts, and the thing bathing suit-esque, and I really talk about that this is her digital thumbprint that she is creating, even at this young age. It will be out there pretty much forever and ever, amen. At least in my opinion, it will be. So we have those conversations as well. So what are some other apps? We all know about Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest. What are some of the apps that adults or parents may not know? What are the ones that are they're coming up and going out and may have a little bit of danger behind them?
I think the two of the worst ones that are out there and are quite popular these days are AskFM and Whisper, which are both anonymous. So you can post a question on either of those two totally anonymously, but which to me is like a recipe for bullying. So for instance, we had an incident at my daughter's school last year where somebody put up, which girls in the seventh grade do you think are the ugliest? So it's anonymous, but it goes out to all these people that they know. So people sort of kind of know who's in the group.
Kind of connect the dots type deal.
Yeah. And then a lot of girls were very upset. So anonymity on the internet is a recipe for disaster. So Whisper is similar to that. AskFM is similar to that. The idea behind them was that people could ask questions and get information without being embarrassed by the question. It's mostly being used for icky things like that. Those are two. Yik Yak is another one that kids are using in a similar way. And there's all kinds of wikis that are out there for kids who, a lot of them are fantastic for kids who are interested in Harry Potter to write fan fiction. But some of those you need to be careful because those are open discussions and generally not monitored by anyone other than like some person sitting in their bedroom at a computer. So if your kid is a big fan of Harry Potter, it's one that came up. Just make sure that if they are participating in those things, that there's some kind of supervision going on.
I am aware of Snapchat. That's another one. It's like 6 or 12 second little videos that you can send, and then they like dissolve or disappear.
Except they don't.
Except they don't. Yes. Well, they want you to believe that they dissolve or disappear, but they're on a server somewhere.
I think this is another thing that parents should understand, and I say this all the time, is that when people say, oh, I feel funny, I don't want to snoop into my child's personal life online, that doesn't seem right, and I wouldn't listen in on their phone call. Well, a phone call is between two people. When you post something on the internet, you've given away the right to privacy. As far as I'm concerned, if my child decides that something is able to go public and put that out on the internet for everyone to see, I don't need to follow any, oh, that's an invasion. What privacy? There's no privacy anymore. So I think that's something parents should get over really quick. If your kid is posting stuff that they think is disappearing on Snapchat, show them the many, many apps that other people have made that make it possible to keep those Snapchats, and they might change their mind.
Definitely. So what about Facebook? Facebook is another one that you have to be a certain age, I believe it is 13, to have a Facebook account. But I've seen 8, 10-year-olds with Facebook. Yeah. My daughters come home and they say, well, so-and-so has a Facebook account. I'm like, no, wait a minute, now how old is she? Right. Now how do you think that happened? And we talked about lying and changing things and what that means. But some parents find Facebook great for them for connecting with cousins and friends across the country. So they've made that parental decision that yes, that my child can have a Facebook account. What are some things that parents could be doing with the settings to make sure that their child's Facebook account is as private as possible?
I first would tell you that nearly 70%, I believe the number 67% of parents of kids who have underage kids who have accounts on Facebook have knowingly lied to put their kid on Facebook. So they are willing participants, obviously the majority of them. That being said, I don't think that many kids are that into Facebook. Okay. So they generally have like gone to other things like Snapchat or Instagram or Uvu for conversations. I think the main thing about Facebook is to check your privacy settings early and often, because Facebook is notorious for bait and switch. You know, yeah. They'll set it up and then all of a sudden it's changed and the default is now friends of friends.
Yeah.
So what you want to do is make sure only their friends can see what they're posting and not friends of friends. So I was reading something the other day, I think in the New York Times, about a kid who was applying to college, and he'd been very careful about Facebook, and when admissions officers asked him to friend him on Facebook, he said sure. But what he didn't realize is that his friends had set their settings so that friends of friends could see. So his friends had pictures of him partying and pictures of him doing things he wouldn't necessarily want a college admissions officer to see. So you want to make sure your circle is as small as possible. And that means only your friends and not friends of friends, and not when you're tagged, anybody can see.
Yeah.
But the main thing is to go back and keep checking, because they constantly are switching it around.
That they do.
Like, yes.
Yes. So let's talk a little bit about Kids Views. You are a co-founder of Kids Views. Can you tell my audience about Kids Views and how it is different than the social media outlets that we've been chatting about?
Well, it's way better, number one. So Kids Views is video by kids for kids. So we call ourselves Yelp meets YouTube for kids under 13. The reason, and I've mentioned that it's illegal to have accounts on all these places, is a set of laws called COPPA, which is a Children's Online Privacy and Protection Act. It's an FTC regulation that is federal law. So Kids Views follows all of the rules set by COPPA about how to deal with children's online privacy, and that makes us the only place where kids can upload their own videos and share them. On Kids Views, every kid is anonymous. They have a username. And a password. We don't know who they are. Every kid has been approved by a parent and with verifiable parental consent. So they don't just say, yes, I'm approved. We actually verify that their parent is who they say they are. And then every video is watched by a human being before it goes up, and every comment is read. So there's no bullying. There's no inappropriate content. There's only kids making their own videos about the stuff they love. They can find other kids who like the things they like. They can like other kids' videos, comment on other kids' videos. There's a bit of a delay because we have to read everything and make sure. So it's not there's no chat room, there's no instant gratification, but you get your videos watched by kids who are interested. And we have all kinds of opportunities for our Kids Views users to get invited to parties and to maybe get to be an interviewer for a celebrity or go to a red carpet or get products for review. So it's a nice community to be a part of. We're two moms who started it together, and it was sort of our answer to wanting our kids to be content creators and not just content consumers online. So we give the kids a chance to create something, to think critically about the stuff they like, not just, I liked it, but, you know, what did you like and why?
How?
Yeah. I know a certain interviewer's daughter who's an excellent reviewer and does a great job all the time. So
I was
going to
say, both my daughters are Kids View reviewers, and they love it. They will go on and they will check, and they'll change their little avatar. They'll change the dress from purple to pink and put a hat on, back to school stuff and book bags and stuff like that. They'll do on their avatar, and they love getting comments from other kids that says, you did a good job, or that's great. And they love putting up the videos. They love talking to the camera and explaining to their world why they like this toy or this product or going to this place.
And that's
the
whole
point.
It's
a lot of fun for them.
Right, that was the whole point, to give kids a place to have their say. That's our tagline, is have your say. But it really is true. There aren't that many places online where kids get to be the ones directing the conversation. It's mostly about people going like, look at this, buy this. And this is them getting that chance themselves. Mm-hmm. So I'm very proud that we started that community for kids, and I'm glad that kids seem to really like it.
And as a parent, I appreciate when we're uploading the videos, it asks questions about the product. What did you like about it most? What did you like least about it? Would you use your own money for it? Like if you had birthday money? So the kids aren't just throwing up videos to be viewed, they're asked critical, thought-provoking questions about these products.
Right, and that's partly to encourage critical thinking and partly because otherwise the camera goes on and the kids are like, so we found that adding the questions gives them a little focus and guidelines before they actually turn the camera on and then don't know what to say. So it works for them and it works for us.
Well, thank you very much for being part of Our Two Cents. Tell everybody where we can find you and where we can find Kids Views.
So Kids Views is at www.kidsviews.com, and it's spelled kind of funny. It's K-I-D-Z-V-U-Z. Basically, if you spell it any way other than the way it's actually spelled, Kids Views, you will be redirected to us. And or you can find me on my own personal blog, where I actually have a lot of articles about kids and tech and safety for kids at hiptohousewife.com. Or you can look on Kids Views Parents, where we write a lot about stuff for teens and tweens.
Thank you very much, Nancy. If you guys didn't get all that, I will have it in the comments below. You guys just click down and take a look at those. And thank you very much for being part of Our Two Cents and sharing your two cents on kids and internet safety.